Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, everybody. It's really wonderful. You know, one of the good parts of running a festival is that you get to meet writers and some of them become friends. And I can say that is the case with both Paramita D as well as Kanishk. So I met Paramita D when she was slightly injured and unwell, and she was so wonderful and welcoming. I met her a couple of times at her place. And I think I was lucky for her because she immediately won the Sahitya Academy Award. So I'd like a round of applause for Paramita D and her story Satpathy, which won her the honor. And young Kanishk Tharoor, who's written this amazing set of short stories and a slightly long one, you can call it a novella. Okay, that's what the session is about. What do you call a long short story or a short novel? So it's very nice to have both of you here. Welcome to Bhubaneswar. And though the session is about sizing up a story, I thought I'd start with a small digression. Both of you have parents who are eminent writers. So I'll start with you, Paramita D. Your mother, Pratibha Satpathy, is an eminent writer. She had won the Sahitya Academy Award a few years ago herself. Your father is also a writer. So how did that affect your growing years? And, you know, I once spoke to a writer, Novelita Davis, and she said that she thought that was the only thing people did. I mean, it was the most automatic thing to do. So was that the case with you as well?
As you had said, Novelita Davidson had done. Well, for the sake of repetition, I keep saying everywhere that I have been grown up in the literary atmosphere, as you have said correctly. And as a child, I used to believe that writers are the most important persons in the world. I too, till now also, I believe in that. And I grew up with books, not many books in the library. We had a medium level of library. Lot of world classic literature in translation I used to read. Whether I understand or not, I don't know. But somehow I grew up with words and letters and sentences and books. Books were there all around me. I was into all other brands, of course. But somehow being with books and being with writers, because very famous writers used to come to our house, and I used to be serving them tea, and I used to be going and participating in those literary functions because my mother would be thinking that she should be around and not for anything. But somehow that has probably germinated something in me, and I don't know. I mean, since people ask, I say, but I do believe that when you grow up in a situation or an atmosphere like that, it affects you in a certain manner, surely, for that.
So writing chose you immediately. And was that the case with you as well, Kanishk? Did you think writing was one of the most important things in the world? And, you know, his surname tells you that he's Shashi Tharoor's son, but his mother is also a very eminent and respected writer, Tilottama Tharoor, and Tilottama Mukherjee or Karun Tharoor, and so he is also, you know, both his parents are writers. So did you grow up seeing writers, feeling you'd be a writer, and thinking writing was the center of your universe?
I suppose so. I mean, my wife, I should also add, is a poet, so not only was I raised by writers, I married one.
You're still being raised by writers.
Yeah, still being raised by writers. You know, first of all, I want to say it's so pleasant and wonderful to be here in Bhubaneswar, and it's a lovely setting. I'm so glad that you're all here to see this session and to take part in this lovely festival. I think at the risk of echoing what Paramita D said, I was raised likewise in a setting full of books. As Malavika D said, my mother is a professor of literature, my father is a writer, as you know, so there was a helpless number of books in the house, and writing really seemed like an obvious thing to do. I think, you know, what's one of the impediments for people who want to be writers is that often it can seem like a completely opaque or implacable, daunting profession. For me, I think, and maybe as well for you, we had the privilege of seeing it done, and it seeming natural and accessible and a reasonable thing to do. So I definitely think that it was something that is that helped me and encouraged me to follow this as a vocation. It also has its drawbacks. You know, I think there's a greater burden on you now as a young writer to make a name for yourself and to not be
the notorious star kid syndrome strikes in literature as well. I doubt it.
But, you know, it's incumbent upon you as a writer to make a name for yourself, no matter what.
Absolutely. So, Kanishk, when you started writing, even before you got, you know, published, you know, since we're talking about various kinds of writing, what was the kind of writing? Did you dabble with poetry as a tortured adolescent? Or did you straight go into prose? Or, you know, did you write blogs since you belong to virtually a post-millennial life?
I unfortunately never dabbled too much in poetry. Perhaps I wasn't tortured enough. We were raised by parents who had really eclectic tastes in literature, not just literature, also folklore, epics, mythology, and a lot of that kind of material. Not exactly modern. Contemporary material really was part of my formation, intellectual formation and creative formation. So I think as a result, some of my earliest stories were more in the vein of mythology, fantasy, historical fiction. When I was, 8 years old, I got obsessed with the Mauryan Empire, and I wrote a series of completely implausible and ridiculous stories about a naval commander in the Mauryan Empire. As you can imagine, these were quite fanciful tales from my childhood. But I think there is a sort of tenuous line from that kind of work to my now more playful, imaginative short stories, where I take liberties with realism and embrace slightly more adventurous plots.
Yes, I'll come back to that. You know how your stories travel around a lot. But coming to Paramita Lee, you know, we were discussing this even a couple of days ago. You know, you have some interesting thoughts about how a story comes into your head, and sometimes it can be something you've seen or read, and sometimes, you know, it's just an idea that you develop into a story. And you have written a lot of short stories, and how many novels have you written? Two. So, but you've written several short stories. So how does a story form in your mind, and how do you know this is just this long?
Since I have been writing for the past 30 years, so it's quite an experience for me. But generally, you know, in my everyday life also, I keep probably looking for stories, and some kind of a feeling, maybe some kind of a concept, some perception, maybe an event, an occurrence, which basically affects me or hits me like a sharp nail, and it actually stays with me for quite some time, and I know that I'm gripped by it, and probably I have to write it in a manner. So then only I think of writing a story. So there is no fixed formula how a story will come to me, but it does come from my conviction of seeing the outside world around me. Basically, it has been like that.
Can you give us an example? I read a story of your sin, which is very, you know, it's about the kind of people we never see written about. So that struck me.
Well, that story, which has been quite circulated quite a lot and been translated into many languages, and probably you must have read it from the little magazine of Antara Dersen, yes. And that story has triggered in my mind, if I am permitted to say so, because of a small news item in the daily newspaper, probably Sambad, that a mother has jumped into the well with three of her kids. So I was quite affected by it, because I know what motherhood is. I'm a mother and many of us are. So what could prompt a mother to do this? Is it poverty? Is it torture? Is it exploitation? Is it seeing a bleak future, a no future? What has actually made this woman do this? And then I thought of a story that Papa in Odia, and the scene is the English translation. It is basically told in the tone of a young boy of 7, who is the sole survivor and who has witnessed the whole process of mother needing to jump with the kids to the well. And I am quite tempted to talk about another story of mine, that is Tara. Very recently it has come out in probably in Sambad annual issue last year. So that is a concept, Tara as a concept. Tara I used here as a concept in the sense, this is about a woman, young modern woman who has been exploited by her husband just for his promotion. So he uses this woman for his promotion. And they go to a party, and this man absconds from the party, and the party is in a private place where 3 of them are there, the chairman of the company. And the chairman of the company starts making advances, and this girl, the young girl, young lady, somehow escaped. And she runs and runs. And I could let loose my imagination that she is somewhere near a jungle, because we have a very beautiful forest here, that is Chandaka Forest. So maybe there's a very lonely road there, and there she meets a woman who is totally flustered, you know, quite luminous. And she was askance, she was thinking, who is this woman at this lone night? Then she says that I'm Tara. She says, no, no, I'm Tara, not you are not Tara. Then I started telling a story. Anyway, so Tara, I'm Tara of Tritaya Yuga, and I am Bali's wife, Tara, who has been acquired by Sugriva, not married, but acquired by Sugriva after Bali's death. I did so because I wanted my child's future. He was crowned the prince, and for myself also. And then when Lakshman came to Sugriva's place, then I was sent by Sugriva to appease him. So I have been used, and I am suffering that exploitation and that agony. And can you do anything? So this woman, this young lady, finds herself as if flying or something, that has been narrated, and she finds herself in the hotel, goes to the washroom, gets little freshened, then goes up to that man. The man was taken surprised. Why have you come back? No, I have come back to you, and I'm sort of in agreement with what you want. Then he says, okay, your husband will get a promotion. Then she says, no. My husband should not get a promotion all through his life. That's the only reason I have come to you. So, all I wanted to say is not that we only write stories on some events, on some feelings, on some experiences, but we also develop a concept into a story.
Okay. So, from Tara to Swimmer Among the Stars. So, your stories, as you said, are playful. I guess it's a different time of life. And they travel to these places that seem like some place you know, but are not quite. And there are some stories like the one with the Moroccan princess wanting an elephant, which are again playful and talk about, you know, the red tapeism and what we encounter in our daily lives, but from a magical perspective, you know, just being slightly not, you know, it's fantasy at some level. So how, you know, do you think the travels you must have had as a child affected the way you write about the world and how you just go to travel?
It's funny that you mentioned that story about the elephant. It's actually a real story, a true story. So it's not quite fantasy, but it was a story that was told to us by my brother and me. I have a twin brother. By a family friend years ago when we were quite small, about a Moroccan princess. He worked for the Indian Foreign Service. And he told us a story about how a Moroccan princess had at some point decided to ask the Indian ambassador for an elephant. And the Indian ambassador, who was keen not to disappoint the princess of Morocco, put in the request for an elephant to be sent from India to Morocco to satisfy this princess. And eventually the elephant was sent, but it was about 6 or 7 years later, at which point the princess had grown up, gone to college, and ceased to have any interest in this elephant whatsoever. So I wrote a story, drama, and then the elephant does arrive in Morocco and has subjected to something of an ordeal. But I wrote a story dramatizing this this episode that had been told to me many years ago. And what was remarkable was when the book was launched last year in January, at the Delhi launch, a woman came to the event, a lovely woman came to the event, who was, it transpired, was the daughter of the Indian ambassador at the time. And she was very moved by this story because she felt it depicted an episode from her own life very well. Even my description of her father, who I'd never seen, never met, she claimed was very accurate. And so it was quite an astonishing thing, actually, to, as you say, produce something in a slightly whimsical spirit, to put it into the world, and for it to come back to you in reality. That is quite a surprise.
So it came from reality, went into your book, and then again had an echo in real life. So, staying with you, Kanish, you know, when you see a situation like that, you could have developed it into a longer story. We have Amitabh sitting in mid-wicket, who has never written a short story. So how do you decide that, you know, this is as long as this story should be? And ask Paramita as well. And are you a prisoner? But now you've written 4 short stories, you have to complete a collection. So are you imprisoned by length at any point?
Well, I mean, you know, this collection of mine wasn't something I necessarily set out to write. They are connected stories thematically and stylistically, but they're not necessarily... they were accumulated over a period of time. When I was putting the collection together, it wasn't that I was setting out on a day-by-day basis to write a short story. Or just that many short stories, right. You know, I think with... I'm trying to get to this because right now I'm in the midst of writing a novel, which is and this is my first novel, and obviously it's quite a different task. But I think at the time when I was writing these short stories, say the one about this elephant, I found that the tone I was striking would really require, really had the intensity to last about 30 pages. A short stories demand a lot of intensity in a way that I don't know if a novel necessarily does. Novels allow you to inhabit and live with a world, a setting for a lot, you know, as an experience, they're quite different, right? And I think what I enjoy about a novel is you know, depending on how fast you read, getting to live in a world for could be days, could be weeks, could be months if you're a very slow reader. Whereas the short story, there's this intensity. And I think for the conceits that I come up with, for example, this one about the elephant, I have a short story that dramatizes the interview between anthropologists and the last speaker of a language. I have a short story that imagines a world riven by climate change and diplomats from the United Nations trapped in near-Earth orbit, that these kinds of very large and kind of adventurous conceits, it's best to explore them within the intense bounds of a shorter form than try to stretch them beyond credulity in a longer form.
Thank you.